Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Miranda Schroers. I'm a professor of environment and climate policy at the Technical University of Munich in our School of Social Sciences and Technology. And I'm very happy to welcome you all today to a very special event that has been made possible for us by a very special relationship between the United States and Germany. The United States Consul here in Munich and the general support of the United States Trade Representative. Today we have as a topic something that is very, very much in the news these days, and that is the relationship across the Atlantic, especially at a time of geopolitical crisis, at a time when we realize that the relationship between the United States, Germany and European partners is of special importance, and that a critical component of that relationship is trade. It is the economic relationship between the United States and the European Union that has helped these regions of the world to flourish, but also many other parts of the world. And for many, many years, we have agreed on the basis of the importance of having a relationship that is open to free trade, a relationship that strengthens the economies on both sides of the Atlantic, as well as a relationship that brings other parts of the world together. But we also know that over the years, this relationship has been strained. We know that there have been ups and downs in this relationship. And we know that right now we are seeing, because of the Russian war in the Ukraine, impacts on the global structures that will also have impacts on the US-German-European trade relationship, as well as an issue that's dear to my heart, the questions of sustainability. We know that our economies, our societies are being heavily impacted by climate change, by a variety of different sustainability challenges, whether that is destruction of rainforests or excessive use of resources or all kinds of pollution that is associated with our lifestyles. And we know that we need Germany, the European Union, and the United States to lead on these questions if we are to have a chance to address rising global temperatures, if we are to have a chance at addressing the very rapid societal problems that are accompanying climate change, water shortages, biodiversity loss, and questions of how different parts of the world will be able to feed themselves. So these questions of sustainability and these questions of trade and economic relationship are very central to what needs to happen globally, and we need leadership to make that happen. And which countries, which regions are better situated for that leadership than the United States and the European Union? So today we have the pleasure of welcoming Ambassador Katherine Tai, who is appointed by President Joseph Biden to be the United States Trade Representative, the person within the cabinet who has responsibility for deepening trade relationships, for strengthening relationships across the Atlantic and with the rest of the world. And we have the honor of having the ambassador here with us. Although online, we're also a university that has learned in the last years how digitalization works. I am also very, very happy that I'll be able to welcome the Consul General, Timothy Liskin, who is here from Munich, where he's based, originally, however, obviously with a United States background. Timothy Liskin has arrived here in July of 2021, has a Master's of Science in National Security Strategy from the National War College. So for many of you in our program, there's a very nice connection here, thinking about how security issues are tied to policy and trade kinds of issues. Consul General Liston also has a very international background. He spent time prior to being here in Ho Chi Minh City, so he's actually something of a South Asia expert. Having lived in Vietnam, you obviously have very, very important security issues going on that side of the world as well. So for some of you who maybe have an interest in what's going on related to China and developments in Asia, he might be a nice person for you to try to catch. Consul General Liston was also at the International Atomic Energy Agency, which for me is very, very important. Questions about energy futures, where we develop in terms of our future energy as a basis of our economic developments, and has spent time at the RAND Institute, as well as having been a Robert Bosch Institute Fellow and a Bundestag Internship Fellow. And I heard him before, he speaks excellent German. Perhaps German parents? No.
German wife.
German wife, that's the other trick. If you can find yourself a partner who speaks another language, that's a great way to learn it. So I'm very happy to welcome you here today. It's a real honor for us, and I think we would all be very excited to continue this relationship in a deeper way in the years ahead. And I'm also very happy to welcome Professor Erskasser, who is also our dean. He arrived here from Harvard University only 6 months ago. Well, actually, he arrived a little bit earlier than that, but he's been here with us officially for 6 months in his new role at the new institute here, the School of Social Sciences and Technology, with a special role of bringing technology and policy together in ways that are unusual for many universities and yet central to how we're going to develop in the future. So I will soon turn the floor over to Erskasser. I just wanted to quickly let you know how things are going to run. At 10:30, we are expecting Ambassador Tai to be joining us online. We will have a keynote speech from Ambassador Tai about the U.S.-European trade relationship, but I think also going into some of the geopolitical questions that are facing us right now. We will have time for questions, and because we have such limited time, I asked a few students ahead of time to be prepared with questions. So we have three students sitting here who will be asking those questions. For the rest of you, I know that might be a little disappointing that you might have your own questions you want to ask. Maybe you can save them for afterwards, and I'd be happy to send them on to the USTR and see if we might be able to get responses from them in some other form. And at 11 o'clock, because of very tight schedules, we'll have to close the event. So those are my words of welcome. I am now going to turn the floor over to Dean Erskasser.
Thank you, Miranda. Dear Ambassador Tai, dear Consul General, dear students, dear guests, dear colleagues, I'm delighted to welcome you to this special event hosted by our newly launched TUM School of Social Sciences and Technology. As we just heard, our school launched last October to tackle some of the most pressing societal challenges by bringing together innovations from the space of technology and science and combine it with insights how society works with our social science understanding of economies, institutions, human beings, to make a real world difference. Now, with this mission in mind, I couldn't imagine a better venue for today's transatlantic dialogue with a vital and consequential question in front of us. How can we work together to align innovation, inclusive economic growth, and ecological sustainability? And let's make no mistake, while the title of our program today, The Trade-off Economics versus the Environment, suggests some sort of a choice, I believe we do not have choice. It can only be economics and, I would say, yes, economics for the environment. We all know the realignment of innovation, economic growth, and sustainability, that's the focus today, is of extraordinary importance to humankind. As we recently learned, and this number stuck in my head, up to 3.6 billion people live in areas highly vulnerable to climate change, with additional severe risks should the Earth warm beyond the 1.5 degree limit agreed upon in Paris. 3.6 billion people live in highly vulnerable areas. Imagine that number and let it sink in. Now, the challenge in front of us is not just a huge one and of highest importance in the famous Eisenhower matrix. It's also one of great urgency. Reacting actually to the latest findings just a few weeks ago presented by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres summed it up in one sentence. He said, the scientific evidence is overwhelming that the world is, quote, on fast track to disaster, unquote. But of course, there's also some good news. We have a wealth of policy tools, new technologies ranging from green tech to AI, and innovation in how we build infrastructures in our collective toolkit to change societies, to reimagine how we build cities, to transform our lifestyles. And these changes together have the promise and potential, for instance, to dramatically reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Researchers at TUM, including Miranda Schreuers as a leading expert, and colleagues around the world can guide us how we build smarter cities and redesign urban areas to mitigate some of the worst effects of climate change. We also have blueprints, for instance, how to create more compact, walkable cities, how to rebuild transportation systems and mobility ecosystems, how to enhance carbon uptake and storage using nature. So there's a whole lot of innovation and knowledge that's available. Take another example. Already since the 80s, we've been discussing concepts of the circular economy, and I'm sure this will be part of the conversation today as well. Some ideas have been tested out in the 90s, including in China. So we have a lot of knowledge that we need to put to good use quite quickly. Yet the slow tempo with which we make use of these insights and innovations points towards another big challenge, I think. Over and again, we need to understand that we can only unlock the benefits of these advancements in science and technology if we understand them in a broader societal, institutional, economic, political, and human context. And as we gather here at the Hochschule für Politik today, I think it's important to remember that we should not only focus on the technological innovation, but also really need to concentrate on the importance of societal innovation. We have seen enormous advancements in technology over the decades, but we have seen less innovation in governance. We have hard questions to answer. How do we bring together the different stakeholders that are necessary to course correct, to make a change, to foster the goals we have in mind, including, of course, leading economies, but also multilateral development banks, companies, financial institutions, and the like. So how do we create this collective action? How do we address that problem? So zooming in on the key interplay today of innovation, economic growth, and ecological sustainability, I'm looking forward to hearing the thoughts of our colleagues from the US, Consul General and Ambassador Tai later on, what the innovative policies and actions that you bring to the table, the proposals you want to drive forward, as we face not so much a trade-off, but really a fork in the road from which there is no point of return. So thank you very much for being here, being with us, looking forward to your remarks. Thank you, Miranda, for organizing it, and welcome again from my side. Thank you.
And now I'm happy to welcome Consul General Timothy Liston.
Thank you very much, Professor Shoya. It's an absolute pleasure to be here today on this very auspicious occasion that we have the opportunity to hear from our highest trade representative, which is one of our primary, shall I say, strategic objectives, and that is trade, global trade. But in many cases, we need partners, of course, to carry out and fulfill American interests and objectives. And there's no closer partner, of course, than our partners in Europe, particularly here in Germany. As was mentioned, I've been consul general here since last July, and I've been a diplomat for 20 years. And there are two posts that weren't mentioned, which have actual residence and applicability to today. My first post was in Lithuania, in Vilnius, 2003 to 2005. And I had the privilege and, quite honestly, luck to watch this newly formed country that had not existed for more than since 1991 join both NATO and the European Union. And for a country that borders a former basically master in terms of Soviet being part of the Soviet Union, there was nothing more that could guarantee the security and prosperity and democratic principles that the Lithuanian people had so so bravely fought for 12 years prior to them joining. So that plays a lot of resonance. And then the other post is I was in Berlin 2005 to 2007 as a trade representative, not the trade officer. And I had the odd honor and privilege to work very closely with the US trade representative out of Brussels, and in coordination with them as we tried to achieve the Doha round and the World Trade Organization for a global trade agreement, as well as being at the very, very beginning, the germination of TTIP. And it was actually a real honor to be able to work on the very, very early days of that. And it showed so closely the promise of these of trade agreements, but also the perils and the difficulties of achieving them. I think some of you have noticed, maybe if you've driven by the Prince Karl Palace, since Friday, we have this big green, there's a big green laser that runs up and down there. That was from our kickoff. And there's the kickoff of Transatlantic Innovation Week. And that's one of the great things that we've been working on in conjunction with our German partners to make this happen, to make this today a reality. And it's really, it's an honor and a real joy to have watched our team work so closely with their German partners all over Germany, but here in Bavaria, in academia, the private sector, and also of course, with the government, Staatskanzlei, not only the state, but the city government, which have been extremely important to making this a reality. So under the motto Partnership for Our Planet, we'll be highlighting this week the role that the transatlantic innovation is playing in the pursuit of greater sustainability and climate protection. There'll be a lot of engaging activities about e-mobility, digital advocacy, hydrogen power, female leaders in tech, the circular economy, and many more. The undergirding principle, though, is that we cannot do this alone. We cannot, as the United States, do this alone. We need to tackle problems like climate change, pandemic, unprovoked wars of aggression, global economic inequities, challenges to human rights, democratic principles, freedom of press. We must all do that together. President Biden said in his 2022 interim national security strategy, we work together to face these global challenges best when we do this together. These problems are complicated. We're in a world of global strategic competition. And the only way that we're going to succeed with our shared principles and values in our interests is if we cooperate and collaborate together. So as part of this Transatlantic Innovation Week, we had the honor and privilege of having our ambassador, Dr. Gutman, come down from Berlin, and she'll be spending a couple days with us at the end of the week. That will be on Thursday, Friday. And she is a woman of many accomplishments, a true intellectual titan when it comes to democratic philosophy. She was the longest serving president of the University of Pennsylvania, one of our finest institutions of higher education in the United States, for 20 years. Before that, she was vice president at Princeton University. So she basically brings a record of amazing accomplishments in leadership. And there's nothing she wants to do more than to move forward the transatlantic relationship and the relationship with Germany. I thought I would share just a couple of her ideas because how she goes about framing her work and objectives. I mean, one of the most important things, and we're going to hear this, I think, time and time again, is advancing alliances. She wants to strengthen our U.S.-Germany bilateral relationship along with the transatlantic alliances and European partnerships, central among them NATO and the EU. To do this, we need to engage with a robust public and economic diplomacy to increase free trade, investment, cultural exchanges, research collaborations. Research collaborations she's very big on. And this might not seem like, it might seem a bit distant and difficult to comprehend. It's like, why is this so important in the transatlantic relationship? Well, if you look at these academic and scientific collaborations, and you put that in the perspective of the pandemic, you look at Pfizer and BioNTech. These two important, we had BioNTech with the know-how coming from Germany, and you had Pfizer coming from the United States with the ability to bring capital, as well as a way to get this amazingly quickly developed vaccine out to the public within 18 months, something that's never happened in human history. That is only happens if you have the framework and the foundations to build off of. And that's what she's really excited about. And she wants to continue to use these collaborative efforts to tackle things like combating climate change and strengthening global health. So I always like to say I have the transatlantic relationship flowing through my veins because I've been vaccinated by the Pfizer BioNTech. And that's just something. It's kind of a concrete example of great transatlantic collaboration. And here we are this week about innovative inclusivity. You know, we're trying to work together towards goals of combating climate change, global health, combating the aggression in Ukraine. We have to think of innovative solutions to do this. And Ambassador Gutman is extremely focused and a big supporter of when you have more diverse opinions in the room, right? When you have diverse people who bring in different backgrounds and experiences, you come up with better solutions. And I think there's no better example of that this week than Transatlantic Innovation Week to say, basically, to make the case every day to new audiences, especially the younger generation. I wish I could say I'm part of this generation, so I'm not anymore. But building the broader relationships in policy and culture, science, business, and defense, we can create more and better jobs, life-saving healthcare, path-breaking scientific research, inspiring arts and cultural opportunities for all Americans and Germans from all types of backgrounds and all walks of race, creed, and color. So this is going on around the Innovation Week. It's going around the whole of Germany. I like to say the epicenter's here, it's in Bavaria, it's in Munich, but we're reaching out to all different kinds of audiences this week around Germany. And there's such great events happening in Frankfurt, Düsseldorf, Leipzig, and Hamburg. The last thing I'll say is that her goal is also publicly advocating for our democratic values, freedom and prosperity, diversity, equity, human rights, and the rule of law. United by these uplifting values, we can defend our liberty, security, and prosperity against Putin's aggression, against the People's Republic of China, and other malign actors and actions. We'll invigorate transatlantic travel, exchange, dialogue, especially focused on the next generation who are the future of our democracies. So she'll be down here on Thursday and Friday. I think you'll hear a lot of these themes. She'll be doing several events, and you're going to hear these themes during her tenure time and time again, because they're so important to the future of our transatlantic partnership. Because if we don't care for the anchors of the relationship, the bridge can get pretty wobbly. So this is an absolute amazing opportunity that she will be focused on over the next 3 years she's here. Now, I would like to, because we'll be moving in about 5 minutes, to hear Ambassador Katherine Tai. I thought I'd officially introduce here in the essence of time. I want to make sure we have that time in case we need it in terms for technical issues. So Ambassador Katherine Tai, as we've heard, was sworn in as a 19th United States Trade Representative on March 18th, 2021. As a member of the President's Cabinet, Ambassador Tai is the principal trade advisor, negotiator, and spokesperson on U.S. trade policy. Prior to her unanimous Senate confirmation, Ambassador Tai spent most of her career in public service, focusing on international economic diplomacy, monitoring, and enforcement. She previously served as Chief Trade Counsel and Trade Subcommittee Staff Director for the House Ways and Means Committee in the United States Congress. In this capacity, Ambassador Tai played a pivotal role in shaping U.S. trade law, negotiation strategies, and bilateral and multilateral agreements, including the recently renegotiated U.S.-United States-Mexico-Canada agreement. Ambassador Tai is an experienced World Trade Organization litigator. She previously developed and tried cases for the Office of the United States Trade Representative, eventually becoming the Chief Counsel for U.S. Trade Enforcement. Before transitioning in federal service, she practiced law in the private sector, clerked for district judges, and taught English in Guangzhou, China. Ambassador Tai earned a Bachelor of Arts degree in history from Yale University and a Juris Doctorate from Harvard Law School. She is also fluent in Mandarin. I don't think there is any better person today to talk about the trade challenges that we face in the global environment, but also the opportunities for cooperation and collaboration. It is an extremely important area for the United States. So with that, I will pass this over to our moderator, and then we will welcome your questions after you hear from Ambassador Tai. Thank you so much for your attention and time.
Thank you so much, Consul General Liston. That was a terrific introduction, and also really interesting to hear about your own background as a diplomat. I think that's something that many of our students are also striving to become. I think you'll see some of these as junior colleagues in the future. We just got the message that Ambassador Tai is on her way, will be here in a few minutes, not here quite yet. So I might use this opportunity to see if we can sort of set the background just a little bit more for the discussion that I think we're going to be having. And I think if you look at the relationship between the United States, Germany, and the European Union over the last 20 years, we have had transformations that have been tied to different political administrations on the American side, as well as very important and dramatic changes in the European Union. We've seen Brexit, we've seen the pandemic that's had all kinds of impacts on our relationships. And I think something that we've also learned in the last weeks and months is that there's actually much more that ties us together than many of the tensions that we've also seen in the relationship in the past decades. And for me, I'm hitting 60 pretty soon. And when you think of that and you think, well, what have I seen happen? I've seen this wonderful flourishing of democracies and globalization and trade. And now I see a world where we're seeing more and more concerns about rise of authoritarianism. We're seeing concerns about anti-globalization. We're seeing some weakening of the European Union, although at the same time in recent years, we've seen some reassuring signs that the European Union is in fact strong. So I think when we're thinking about the relationship today, it's helpful to put it in this larger context and think about why is it so important that we have a strong relationship across the Atlantic. And you said something in your introduction, Consul General Liston, that caught my ear, and that was, what I see as an emerging Cold War, a new kind of Cold War with Russia on the one hand and rising tensions with China on the other. And that raises for me big questions about what is the likelihood of our being able to return to a situation where we see global partnerships and not regional blocks forming into a new kind of more tense global structure. So I don't know to what extent Ambassador Tai will be able to go into these kinds of questions, but I think it's important for us to be thinking about where are we going globally? And the reason for our transatlantic relationship and why I see that is so important is precisely because we have democracies here. And I will end my words now because I'm very, very happy to see that Ambassador Katherine Tai, the United States Trade Representative, who is joining us from London, is here. So, Ambassador Tai, are you ready to go? We've had a nice introduction of you and your background already, so I'm not going to repeat that, and I'm going to immediately give the floor to you. Ambassador Tai, please.
And thank you so much for the kind introduction. Thank you also, all of you, for your patience as I start my day off with being a little bit tardy. Thank you very much also to the Technical University of Munich for hosting me today and putting together this event, as well as all of you I want to thank for being here. Rebuilding and revitalizing our relationships with partners and allies around the world is one of the Biden administration's top global priorities. President Biden believes that we are stronger when we are working together rather than on our own. Ahead of his first international trip after taking office, he said that the defining question of our time is, can democracies come together to deliver real results for our people in a rapidly changing world. As proven by our successes in delivering concrete, economically meaningful results for our citizens over the past 15 months, the resounding answer seems clearly to be yes. And our work to strengthen transatlantic cooperation to address our shared challenges is one of the clearest and best examples. We started this new era of engagement and cooperation last June when the United States and European Union launched the Trade and Technology Council, which we are calling by its short name, the TTC. The TTC is a forum that will facilitate US-EU collaboration on pressing economic and trade issues and on ways to ensure that the rapidly evolving technological landscape will drive competitiveness and prosperity for the years to come, while reflecting US and EU standards. We are working together on issues that for too long have gotten short shrift in trade talks, like how to improve labor standards and protect the environment as part of the core strategy in our economic policies. We are also looking at how we can harness the potential of the digital economy to benefit both our workers and our businesses. As democratic market economies, we are examining the challenges posed by non-market-based actors that undermine our economic and national security interests through distortive, anti-competitive practices. The second TTC co-chairs meeting will take place in France next month, and I am really excited to continue this work with our European partners. But our transatlantic work is not limited to the TTC. Under the Biden administration, we have managed to resolve irritants of the past to allow us to address our shared global challenges as they arise going forward. Last year, we resolved the 17-year-long dispute involving Boeing and Airbus at the WTO. We also announced a global minimum tax deal with a broad coalition of partners, including Germany. Chancellor Scholz played a particularly important role in negotiating this deal while he was serving as Germany's finance minister, and he has been instrumental in generating additional support across Europe. Additionally, we reached a historic agreement with the EU on steel and aluminum trade and launched negotiations aimed at creating the world's first carbon-based sectoral arrangement by 2024. This arrangement is particularly important in the context of our sustainability goals. The United States and the European Union have laid out an ambitious global climate agenda, and this arrangement will help us address climate change, reduce emissions, and protect key domestic industries and jobs. It is an example of how sustainability is a fundamental pillar of our trade agenda, and how we can use trade tools at our disposal to advance our environmental goals. I've already had several discussions with Minister Habeck on how we can further use trade policy to advance our climate ambitions. And you will not be surprised to hear that Minister Habeck is very, very focused on this particular issue. Moving forward, the Biden administration is committed to building on our successes over the last year and working together with our partners and allies on our shared priorities. For example, Russia's invasion of Ukraine has further underscored the urgency of President Biden's call for democracies to come together. And we are working with our European partners to create consequences for Russia in multilateral institutions and ensure that it pays the economic costs for its unjustified and unprovoked acts of aggression. Once again, this is an example of how our shared democratic values can help us confront the most pressing global issues. Today, we face urgent challenges from the dangers of climate change and environmental degradation to the unfair policies and practices of non-market economies that are undermining the rights of our workers and rules-based trading system to the actions of autocracies that threaten the fundamental rule of law in the global order. To meet these challenges, we must work closely together and remain united. And that is not to say that we will always agree, because we will not. In fact, conversations with close allies often produce the most candid and honest feedback, which isn't always easy for each of us to hear. But by relying on the foundation of respect that we have created together, we can work through our differences to achieve positive results for people on both sides of the Atlantic. This transatlantic trade relationship continues to be of the utmost importance. And I am optimistic, even with all of the challenges, that we can accomplish so much together if we continue the spirit of collaboration that has defined our engagement so far. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ambassador Tai. That was a great discussion that builds on some of the things we were talking about before you could join us. And I would actually like to begin with a question that my colleague Tim Butte asked. And this has to do with the bipartisan support for US trade. And the rising problems of protectionism and export controls that we're seeing in various parts of the world. Perhaps because of COVID and the war in Ukraine, even pressures to move more in the direction of protectionism. And the question is, how can we assure that climate change doesn't become a pretext for even further protectionism? The title of your talk was Economics Versus the Environment. And here I think the question is, how do we integrate environment and trade? So I turn the floor back to you.
Well, this is certainly a provocative question posed in a somewhat provocative way. Let me first engage on some of the premises baked into the question, and then let me come to your specific question and point on economics and environmental objectives. So I am very, very careful, and generally I do not use the term protectionism. The reason why is I think that the way we talk about trade also needs to evolve, and the way we think about trade. For many, many years, I think in the post-World War II era, we have thought about trade as something that needs to be liberalized maximally. And the premise to this is that the more that we trade with each other, the more peace and prosperity will result. And in fact, I do think that this is largely the premise that underlies the WTO and the multilateral trading system as it has existed for the past many, many years. And I think that there was every reason to believe during those decades that we were right, that all we needed to do was just to trade a lot, trade more, and freely in as unfettered a way as possible. And that the more of these connections were generated, the more we would rely on each other, and the better off we would all be. That this was the path to a better, more secure world. I think a number of things have happened, just say in the past 5 to 7, let's say even 10 years, that caused me to wonder whether this vision for globalization leading us to a better, more secure world has run its course. And if we don't need a course correction to move us towards and take lessons from these past years to move us towards a sense of more security and more optimism and hope. So a couple of the disruptions that I'd like to highlight. In 2016, for example, the first disruption will be a backlash against this version of globalization that we started to see. One happened with respect to the European Union in 2016. In the United Kingdom, we saw the Brexit referendum vote. That was very surprising to many people, including those of us in the United States watching the vote. I think that we expected, watching the polls, that it would be close, but don't know that we expected that that referendum would succeed. And that has led to the multi-year process for Brexit, which I know has been really affecting of the entire European Union, in the process of losing one of the members. It is a little bit like a divorce, which here from London and when I visit Brussels, I know actually continues to go on. Not all the issues are settled, and the European Union and the United Kingdom continue to have to negotiate some parts of what it means for Brexit to happen. Of course, in the United States in 2016, we also had a very consequential vote, and that was the election of President Donald Trump. Now, I work in trade policy, so I'm only going to address the implications of President Trump's election through American trade policy. But as all of us have seen over the course of the Trump administration and those 4 years, President Trump took a very, very different approach to trade. And in fact, his trade policies were a hallmark of his campaign and his political brand. And that America First energy is something that we are also extremely mindful of in the Biden administration, and having gone through those 4 years in terms of being a lesson that we feel we need to learn from. We cannot just go back to the world in 2015 and pretend like these things didn't happen. We feel strongly that we have to take history as it's happened, and we have to adapt. The third, and I'll speed up a little bit. Second set of disruptions around COVID, the pandemic, and our supply chain disruptions. And the third set are more recent, and Russia's invasion of Ukraine, which, according to our earlier theory about more trade leads to more peace and prosperity is something that simply should not have happened. One WTO member on this basis and this theory should never have been incentivized to aggressively act out and invade another WTO member. But here we are in a version of this globalized world where I think we've got to think about things differently. And therefore this, you know, free trade equals good, protectionism equals bad dichotomy is one that I think we need to revisit. So, you know, in export control, I think you have to examine the objectives of the policies we're talking about. Export controls are about controls on technology. It is a national security tool. Let me move this over into the use of economic policy to advance environmental goals. The way our global economic system has been structured, based on the premises I just talked about, has allowed for the free flow of capital across borders to chase the lowest cost. And what that has rewarded, the incentives of this system, are to reward lax environmental protections and, frankly, lax worker protections. Protecting and having high standards for workers and the environment mean higher costs, but they are critical to resilience and sustainability. So in this era that we're in refashioning globalization to a globalization 2.0, what we really need to think through is how can we adapt the rules of trade to incentivize firm behavior, to take into account more than just efficiency, but to promote and reward decisions that are made to pursue sustainability for our people and for our planet? End of answer. I apologize for taking so long.
At all. Very interesting. And I think what you're saying here is something that resonates for a lot of us, because we know that there are a lot of challenges in the existing structures that we have that have led to lots of unease. Brexit is one thing you mentioned. Certainly with your being in London right now, I'm sure that's a very real discussion for you, as is the war in the Ukraine. We have a series of other questions that the students would like to address. So I'm going to invite our first student, Alina Weiss, who's going to come to a different microphone and will be asking you a question that she's prepared. And Alina, maybe you can just introduce yourself real briefly too.
Hello, dear all. I hope you can hear me well. Thank you for this very special event and the interesting remarks that all of you presented here. I'm a graduate student from Utrecht University, where I study sustainable development and governance. So these are the topics I'm particularly interested in. And currently I am a PhD student here at the Chair of Environmental and Climate Policy. So my question concerns the relationship between China and the US. So maybe you can provide me with more insights on the US vision on how to deal with the complex relationship with China on the one hand side and the US interest of maintaining it as a trade partner on the other hand. And can also agreements on, for instance, environmental regulations or more sustainable or circular concepts on in regards to manufacturing be a feasible way forward?
Just a minute. Yeah.
Unmute. Yes. It's only been 2.5 years and I still forget to unmute. Well, this is the question, one of the questions that occupies a lot of our time in the US administration, which is the US-China relationship. And obviously this relationship is larger than just the trade and economic relationship, but obviously the trade and economic relationship is enormous. We are today the two largest economies in the world. And so the way that we relate to each other has impacts that go beyond our two economies. It will really impact the entire world economy. I think that baked into your question is an acknowledgement of the high levels of tension in this relationship, both the trade and economic relationship and the overall bilateral relationship. And this is a complicated relationship. It is going through a difficult time. I think that, again, if I take the world from 5 to 7 years ago and contrast it with the world that we are in today, we did have more avenues for at least communication and engagement 5 to 7 years ago than we do today. And I heard the professor talking earlier about this feeling of a world that is settling towards a kind of a Cold War kind of, you know, chilliness. I hope that's not where we end up. The way you've asked your question is a really smart one, which is beyond where we are today, and beyond where it feels like the inertia will take us, what is the vision for how the United States would want to relate to China in the world? If not today, what are we aiming for in 5 years or 10 years? And I think that we've not yet quite articulated this vision. Politically speaking, right now in the United States, and this has been true for many years, the only fight about China is whether or not you're being tough enough. But one aspect that concerns me is that in the race to be tough, often we lose sight of the very sober and strategic conversation we need to have about what is the nature of what is not working. And how do we get to a better place? The fact of the matter is, whether it's in 5 years or 10 years or 25 years, the United States and China will be coexisting on this planet. And so do we feel we are collectively in a better place if we have our arms crossed and we refuse to look at each other? Or if we have some parameters for how we interact. The fact of the matter is it's not just in our control. This is a bilateral relationship. We have decisions we need to make, but the Chinese have decisions that they need to make as well. And they have been making a lot of decisions. So I think part of the question for me is, what is the strategy and the position that we pursue under two circumstances? One, we would continue to push China to make reforms, market-based reforms to its economy. But on the second track, acknowledge, and I think that if China were to do that, it would help to resolve a lot of our tensions economically. But until China decides that it will do so, and unless it does, I think we as the United States also need to be realistic and pursue a set of policies that will allow us to take defensive measures that ultimately, I think, will help to prevent this relationship from devolving further or from becoming really flammable. So some of my thoughts there, it really is a very important question and a hard one.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ambassador Tai. We're now going to turn to the next question. This will be coming from Jules Bertenis. And Jules is just now making his way to the microphone.
Sorry, thank you very much. So first of all, thank you for a super interesting speech. So my name is Jules Bertenis from Luxembourg. I'm a student at the TUM Master of Science in Politics and Technology. I want to ask you a question around the current status of the TTIP negotiations, because with German Finance Minister Lindner mentioning the re-entering of talks, I want to ask if you see any chances such an agreement coming together, while also keeping in mind the current political trend of sustainability, and as you stated on your first TTIP website, quote, maintaining high levels of health, safety, and environmental protection, unquote, or if such ideas of sustainability would not be the main focus at this point.
Well, thank you for that question. TTIP does still come up sometimes, it turns out. And yes, I did hear Germany's new finance minister make his comments. Those have not been the TTIP has not really been the subject of conversation between the US and the European Union or even the conversations that I've had in getting to know Minister Habeck. Look, I think that consistent with the worldview that I've put out there, I think the TTIP is a product of its time, which, you know, I think the last time pen was put to paper on TTIP was 2016. And so that was 6 years ago. A lot of things have happened since then. And I think that the US-EU focus on our collaboration is taking a different form on trade now. What I've said to those who were very, very interested in the TTIP is that that spirit of collaboration, of working together, of enhancing US-EU, this transatlantic partnership, has now been transported from the body of TTIP into the body of the TTC. And in many ways, I think that the TTC is intended to be something to keep up with the times. It is forward-looking. It is looking at the challenges we face in the digital transformation. But I think it's also, the TTC is intended also to be a forum and a set of relationships that can continue to adapt, again, to President Biden's point, in a rapidly changing world. So there's the digital transformation that we're contending with. There's the effects of the pandemic and this kind of, I like to describe the world economy right now as a great clock that used to run seamlessly, but where there's sand in the gears and there are pieces that have maybe fallen out and are in the wrong place. How do we work together on these supply chain issues? More recently, with Russia's invasion of Ukraine, that is a serious geopolitical national security development, but it also has serious economic consequences. We will be using the TTC to adapt to these new realities and expanding out the conversation to include what are the things that we can do together to address the crises that are going to come as a secondary matter from the original crisis of the invasion. So I think that's what I would say, which is, you know, these issues of sustainability as well, to the extent that that was something that even 5 to 7 years ago, we knew we needed to address in the transatlantic relationship, that part of the spirit of collaboration has also been transported to the TTC.
Yes, and Ambassador Tai, as our next student, Lena Ruhl, makes her way to the microphone, I'm wondering if you could just say a word or two more about the meaning of the Ukraine crisis for the relationship. This is very, very real for all of us here. It's right around the corner. We have lots of Ukrainians who are with us here. We see the impact it's having on the European economy right now, on gas relations between the United States and Europe. And I was hoping you might be able to say a few words on where do you see this going? What does this mean? It's a huge change from my perspective.
It is a huge change. To my point earlier, this is exactly the type of thing that we thought globalization would prevent. And I know Germany is in many ways of the European countries, geographically also, but I think historically you've been on the front lines. I was in Berlin the couple days at the beginning of Russia's invasion of Ukraine, and I saw that the first night that the Brandenburg Gate was lit up in the colors of the Ukrainian flag. And just to talk to the counterparts and the colleagues that I met in Berlin, I could feel and see the emotion that Germans feel around this. We as Americans feel like we're a part of your history. I'll share with you on a personal side, my husband grew up in a U.S. Army family, moved around a lot as a kid, but when he was born and when he graduated high school, he and his family lived in Germany three times. And actually he graduated from the American High School in Frankfurt. I don't know that he's got very good German language skills, but he has a very deep appreciation for German beers and beer making. His first opportunity to live in Germany as a child was when he was four, and his little brother was one, and his father was stationed in Fulda, which is right on that front. And at the time, the height of the Cold War, this would have been in the 1970s, you know, had there been an attack then, I think that, you know, that would have been one of the first places to get flattened. And we sent our soldiers there with their young families to take on the risks along with the German people to defend freedom and democracy. So we also are very affected by what is happening, because this, you know, post-war world is one that we've really invested in with all of you. I sense the degree to which the invasion, the war, is existential for Europe. I just remark that the speed, the very fast speed, and the strength of the conviction of the United States and the European Union, along with the United Kingdom and a number of our allies, to come together to push back, to condemn, and to take significant action to stand up to Russia and to stand with the Ukrainians is something that inspires hope for me. Again, to last June, when these things hadn't happened yet, that question that President Biden posed about can democracies come together to produce real results for our people in a rapidly changing world? And the answer has to be yes. And I'm very inspired by the fact that that is exactly what we're doing.
I also find it very inspiring and amazing to see, one, the strength of the U.S. support for the Ukrainians right now. It's really remarkable, and it's very grateful from a European perspective to know that that support is there, and that this really is a partnership in a very difficult time. We have one final question for you. This is from Lena Ruhl. So we've had a sort of a Dutch perspective and a Luxembourgian perspective, and now we'll have a German perspective on the question. Lena, please.
Yes, so hello, thank you very much for taking the time today. I really enjoyed listening to your thoughts. So my question is regarding the car industry, especially because, I mean, the automobile sector is, well, still heavily polluting, and carbon-free solutions are only slowly emerging. And Germany and the United States also belong to the largest importers and exporters globally, and trade between both countries is especially strong. So with this background, how do you see Germany's and the United States' role in this sector, and how would you assess potential regulatory measures? For example, I don't know, a tax on highly polluting cars, or I don't know, some incentives for electric vehicles to reduce pollution?
This is a fantastic question. It's really smart. You're right. Our auto industries for both Germany and the United States, it's something that we're really proud of and almost defines a sense of national pride and identity. For you, you've got the Autobahn. For us, we've got miles and miles and miles and miles of road connecting all the different parts of our country, which you can only do by using the car. So you're right. We are leaders in this industry, which also means that we feel quite often in trade that we are competitors. But as industry leaders, there should be a lot of leadership that we can exercise by coming together. I think you're absolutely right about that. In terms of how we do that and looking at regulatory measures, and you know, you're talking about the stick of taxes on pollution, or the carrot of incentives for electrification, for instance, and the development of new technologies and transition to cleaner automobile technology and standards. I think that we are looking at all of these things. There is actually a quite controversial proposal in the U.S. Congress that I hear from our trading partners all the time, from the Europeans, from the Japanese, from the Canadians and the Mexicans, because the North American auto industry is quite integrated, and it creates incentives for electric vehicle makers that many of our trading partners are concerned favor the U.S. industry versus the other industries. And I think that part of this is we are all struggling, I think, in trying to figure out how to incentivize the behavior that we are looking for, while also being concerned about, in the US in particular, this is an area where I think that we have a lot to learn from the Germans and from other of our trading partners, which is over these last decades of, you know, a very aggressive view and vision for globalization, we have seen a considerable part of our industrial manufacturing base eroded. And it is leading us to a real sense of insecurity that's been punctuated by the, you know, traumatic experiences that we've had through the pandemic, where, you know, one day we couldn't predict that we all needed surgical masks. Everyone around the world needed surgical masks at the same time. And I actually had this conversation with Minister Altmaier when he was my counterpart about a similar experience we had in the United States and Germany, needing to figure out, well, if we're not making masks ourselves right now, because most of the world's masks are made in only one country, and that country happens to be the one that's locked down for COVID earliest, how can we adapt? And we found it actually quite difficult to adapt, that we had lost a lot of the, we had moved offshore a lot of the machines, a lot of the textile making, and even the machines for making the machines to help us produce these products. So this is just to say that I think for us in the United States, and looking at an industrial strategy going forward, including for autos, that is going to be sustainable, that part of what we also need to balance is how we can rebuild some critical amount of our own manufacturing. And there is a lot of tension that will arise around this, but I'd like to come to the central premise in your question, which is this is really an area where we should also be working together. And I appreciate that reminder from you.
Ambassador Tai, thank you very much for taking time today from what I know is a very, very busy schedule. There's a group of students here who are taking courses in international relations, and other students who are taking courses on sustainability, and also students who are very interested in questions of digitalization and how things move forward in what we often talk about is Industry 4.0 or even beyond. So I think this is an area where there's a lot of room for talking together in the future about how we can do more research, student exchange, as well as obviously economic cooperation. So thank you so much for taking time today. I'll let you decide if you have time for a final closing word, and then we'll let you go.
Well, thank you so much for the opportunity to engage. I'm glad that we were able to do this. And one of my favorite things to do in life is to speak with students, because I loved being a student. I often still fantasize about going back to school. But more importantly, you are our future. I'm so delighted to hear that there is such a focus in the studies here around sustainability. We are going to need you. And we are going to need you to push beyond the traditional ways of thinking and to challenge the traditional mode of our international relations and our international economic system to bring about a kind of a revolution that is really going to be required for us to be able to continue to enjoy what this world, what this planet, and what each of us has to contribute to what I hope will be of peace and prosperity. So I want to thank all of you for all of the work that you are doing now, and also all the work that you will be doing going forward. It's been a delight and a real honor to be with you today.
Thank you so very much. And good luck with the rest of your work. We know you have lots of very important things to do.
Thank you so much.
And also thank you so much to Consul General Liston. It's really an honor to have you here. I think for all of the students too, it's not every day that we get to speak with such high level people. So thank you very, very much. And I don't know if you have a minute left, if you have to run right away, if any students might still have a question.
Yeah, I can stay for a couple minutes. I first want to point out our team from the consulate is really the ones who were working with you guys.
Come up, why don't you come up here and then.
All right. I've got a different life, I can't go anywhere without paper. It's just sad. I didn't know what I'm going to get asked. So really quickly, thanks to John Stubbs and his team and Christina Mata. It's been, it's always these events and coming together. There's always peaks and valleys, but this is just another example of the great cooperation we have with TUM and with your institute. So thank you very much for making this a success, a rousing success. I don't know. I it's fascinating. She really was very frank and candid about her answers, which is really important because in trade, particularly trying to figure out how to get to that, whether it's a non-tariff trade barrier, or trying to find standards and norms, or just getting to where you need to be that each side gives a bit, it's so important to understand what are thinking about this and understanding where the United States is coming from, but how we can do it together as partners. So I was really, really, really impressed with, she's an amazing woman and just amazing.
She's a very good speaker.
Yes, and very mega brain, as they say. So it's really good. Look, I can stay for a couple minutes, but I do want to make an offer. I am always happy to meet you guys. Are studying a really important area in transatlantic relationship or trade, security. If you do want to talk Southeast Asia in terms of Trans-Pacific partnership, I served 7 years in Vietnam, so I was there. Working on the South China Sea issue constantly, and watched Vietnam go from a very skeptical, suspicious partner to one of our pillars in Southeast Asia, which is extremely important because we couldn't do our Trans-Pacific partnership, I'm sorry, our Indo-Pacific partnership without them. And there's a very complicated relationship, but really, really important that we get it right. And I think it shows the importance of diplomacy when we're trying to achieve our goals in an area that's going to be very important. The professor did mention something I wanted to address and about the Cold War and breaking into regions. We're in basically what I said, a strategic global competition. I don't think anyone would say anything against that. But there's a lot of ways that we can cooperate globally, but using regional alliances, regional groups to kind of move in our interests forward and confront China and his aggressive behavior, not only in Asia, but around the world. And one of those groups is the Quad that's been formed under the Biden administration. It's basically United States, Australia, Japan, and India. These are some of our largest democracies out in the Pacific. We welcome, of course, Korea as a valuable partner. They're one of our most important allies in Asia, particularly that they're at the front line of another autocratic society with nuclear weapons, which is always a potential destabilizing issue. So yeah, please let me know if we can get together, we can talk, we can set something up, and we can do it thematically. I'd always like, because I'm consul, CG here in Bavaria, tying it to U.S.-Bavarian, U.S.-German relations is really important. But if you look how Germany has now advanced itself in Asia, you're sending over the frigate Bayern was no coincidence. It's going out there to basically underscore Germany's support for the rule of law, international freedom of navigation, and these interests that we also hold very dear. Support of the UN Convention on Law of the Sea. So happy to always talk about that stuff. And I could take one or two questions if anyone has them. Sure.
Going back to the last question the ambassador answered, and on the trade relations with China, on the example of the masks, similarly can be said of the electrification of mobility. The introduction of Chinese electrical manufacturing and the huge industrial base has helped massively in reducing the prices and to make these solutions more accessible. So there is a worry that we will lose on innovation or this cheap industrial base coming forward and putting these solutions forward. So isn't there a worry that this confrontation might impede progress in this field, electrification of mobility? Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, look, I'm not going to, this is one of the things being CG in Bavaria, CG in Bavaria, and I'm always reticent to speak about specific trade issues with China. But what I can say is that we're continuing to move out on our strategy to build resilience and competitiveness, not only in the United States, but in Europe, in terms of supply chain. I think, you know, you're hitting an important issue that we all have felt during the pandemic. And given what's going on in China, actually today with the lockdowns, what looks like to be a future lockdown in China, in Beijing, because they have over 60 or 70 cases of COVID, and there's mass testing going on, which is usually a precursor to more stringent actions to fill President Xi's zero COVID policy. We continue to feel the ripple effects of what's going on there. And it just shows the exposure of the United States, of much of the world, to sole source supply chains, and where we have actually built up this based on assumptions that China would be engaged more in the world, and this is kind of where we went. But we've noticed for the last basically decade, this is not the intent of China. So we're diversifying our markets. We're limiting the impact of Beijing's harmful practices, and we're working with our allies and partners and using the full range of tools that will help defend economic interests, as Ambassador Tai was noting. This is something that we're moving out on. You know, Germany has stepped up in a lot of ways to make PPE available. I mean, a lot of companies that weren't doing it before the pandemic but had the resources and technology to do so did step up. The question is, is it competitive? And it goes back to Chinese practices of, well, is it state subsidies? And there's a lot of ways we can address that in international organizations, but also bilaterally. So it's a difficult question. I thought her answers were very, if we're frank, and that it's complicated. You know, when I was studying at National War College, we called these wicked hard problems, because they're much more difficult. I mean, as globalization moved forward, this is just, it became a more difficult world. But yeah, thank you for the question. Okay.
Sir, thank you for taking the time to talk with us today. My name is George. I'm a master's student here at the Hofbe. Based off your observations, your experiences over the past several weeks and months as the consul here in Munich, how do you think Russia's invasion of Ukraine is prompting Europe at large, including institutions like the EU, and then individual member states like Germany and other countries throughout Europe to reevaluate their relationships with other authoritarian countries such as China in the the wake of a act of aggression from authoritarian state to a democratic neighbor?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great question. I would say, I mean, it's pretty clear in terms of our sanction regimes that 33 countries have already signed up, but there's more that we've been able to bring to bear close to the half of the world's economy to impose sanctions on Russia due to its unprovoked war and invasion of Ukraine that has basically shattered 75 years of peace that we've worked towards, all because one person has decided Ukraine can't choose its own path of freedom and democracy and its own security guarantees. I'm sure, China takes all of this, they're very strategic in their thinking, and they look at this, I'm sure, with pause. What it does, though, and I think this is probably Putin's biggest miscalculation, is that it actually brought the West closer. You know, despite all his disinformation campaigns, and it shows also that NATO matters. This is the security anchor of Europe, that this alliance has guaranteed the peace, stability, and security of Europe and the United States, for that matter, for, you know, over basically 75 years, for seven decades. And there's nothing more that underscores its viability as the security instrument, defensive security, collective defensive security instrument of Europe, than Finland and Sweden now considering joining, because this is what, with shared values, democratic societies, but also they're bordering on Russia. It's good to guarantee that. I mean, they're taking a serious look at this. You know, Germany and France, you know, all the allies realize that the only way we're going to protect, you know, be able to guarantee this way of life and to continue our shared principles is that we have to work together and strengthen our resolve. And this is why we have over, the United States has over 100,000 troops here. This is why Secretary of Defense Austin and Secretary of State Blinken were in Kiev yesterday, actually 2 days ago, and basically underscored our support for the continued, you know, continuing efforts of the Ukrainian people and its military to guarantee victory. We want Ukraine to win. We want to give them the means to do so. And when I say we, I mean, do mean the United States and our partners. In order to successfully win this battle, win this war, they're going to have the resources and capabilities to do so. And that's why there's training of Ukrainians right now in the region to make them more, to make them viable and as a capacity to use different weapon systems. And that's extremely important, but we also need to continue to put the economic pressure on Russia to change the behavior and consider how to get out of this and how to actually find a peaceful solution. Now, we're ready. We've been ready since the Russian military was parked on the borders of Belarus and Ukraine to find a peaceful and viable solution to this. So I think it has redoubled our resolve in terms of what's important to us, because as was said, you know, we have more autocratic and totalitarian regimes in the world than democracies right now. It's about 72 to 68, according to one of the recent study. So we have to really redouble our efforts on this. And we have to show, as President Biden says, that democracies can work together to bring the dignity of the individual, the freedoms that democracy guarantees, and also the prosperity that free markets bring, and not in terms of, you know, and exactly countering to what autocracies have shown how they function in the world, exactly the opposite. So thanks for the question. It's a difficult slog. This is not easy, and nor can we speculate on when it's going to be over. But what we do know is that we have a whole host of countries that think, these, and as they say in German, gemeinsame Werte, you know, shared principles and values behind the Ukrainians right now, and supporting their efforts to choose their own path of freedom and choose their own path of security. That's it. Okay. Thank you. One last question. Okay. Sure.
Thanks. Sorry. My name is Mary. I'm a master's student here as well. This is more of a trade-oriented question, because before I was a master's student, I was working on Canada-US-Mexico cooperation in Ottawa for the implementation of the environmental provisions of the NAFTA and now the CUSMA.
Okay.
And so we'll see how it goes. But when we think of trade agreements in the next, you know, maybe 15 or 20 years, and the effective enforcement of the provisions that are integrated into those trade agreements, I'm wondering what effective enforcement mechanisms look like to you or to the US government, if it's a focus more on resolving issues bilaterally and kind of keeping it in the family, or if you see a role for multilateral institutions to play almost an arbitration role or a third party?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. And I will be the first one to answer, admit right now that I don't want to answer this completely, because the way we go about it in the government is really USTR Tai is the expert, not the expert. She's the ambassador. She's our trade negotiator. And in these areas of policy are extremely sensitive. She answered the very first question is very thoughtful, but was very, you can see each word when you talk in trade, as you know yourself, is a loaded, you know, how do you define protectionism? What is this? So that's all really important. What I can say is that if you look into the Biden administration's interim national security strategy, which will be coming out, I think, in very shortly, the real one, the real deal, and which will be charting our course for the next couple of years, there is definitely putting more emphasis on multilateral organizations. So when you think that you know, the WTO remains an extremely important organization to resolving a lot of these trade difficulties, is a lot done on the bilateral. Of course, I mean, she mentioned the EU, the Airbus Boeing case that we finally have gotten resolved. I worked on that case back in Berlin, you know, talking to the German government about this is all done in Brussels. So I want to make sure that's clear, but you need to hear from partners. So you try to understand what, you know, where Germany's coming from. That was 2005 to 2007. These things take a long time, but when there's an organization or where there's a common interest to find a mutual way forward, it's a whole lot easier to use these multilateral organizations effectively. Also looking at them, how can they be more effective? Which is, I think, getting to your point is, how can we shape these organizations to continue to preserve the international order? Having countries not pick and choose from certain parts of the WTO, but rather invest themselves wholly into it and use those to resolve some of the more difficult problems. There's also international organizations like WIPO, the World Intellectual Property Organization, and effectively using those to protect intellectual property, whether it's through the EU, you know, European countries, the United States, Canada, Mexico. Those are effective ways to change certain behaviors of certain countries, you know, because that's, as I said before, strategic global competition makes things more difficult. And this going back to Germany has been one of the masters and experts of using multilateral organizations. So there's a lot of expertise that my colleagues in Berlin definitely engage on, because this is really, really important. And having a leader, a economic powerhouse like Germany, be part of the solution within the context of the EU and with our bilateral relationship is extremely important to get to where we continue to have the international order protected as a rule-based society. All right, thanks.
Consul General Liston, thanks so much. Thanks to your team. John Stubbs was really, really critical for us in organizing this whole thing. The security guards who are sitting here who never get the attention they deserve, because you guys do really important work as well. And of course, our electronics team here, they've been working late at night and doing emails back and forth with London. So thanks to everybody. And I have to admit, I'm spacing on your name. We just met, but
Christina Ma,
thanks so much for joining us as well. And I hope we have more exchange in the
Absolutely.
Future.
Absolutely. Thanks so much.
And thanks to you all.